Carl, the Federal Reserve increasing that benchmark rate by 25 basis points. The Federal Reserve has suggested that inflation has eased, but is still elevated. Let's talk about what happens now to the US dollar, to the Canadian dollar.
Right. So, you know, I think the key point in that sentence there is the prior language in the statement that came out in the last Fed meeting only said that inflation was elevated. In this case, we've got a acknowledgement of easing inflation pressures in the U.S. economy. You know, it's cautious optimism at this point. They're not saying that inflation has come down in a sustained way. They're not, you know, suggesting that they're going to react to that immediately, but they are acknowledging that you are seeing that decline in prices. And so, you know, that brings the Fed into closer alignment with where the Bank of Canada is. But of course, in Canada, we are looking at an economy that is far more interest rate sensitive and a central bank that has already sort of taken the hawkish blinders off and is now positioned for a pause.
Given that the language out of the Bank of Canada recently suggested there would be a conditional pause and we are possibly in a wait and hold situation with the Federal Reserve, where does that leave the U.S. dollar, which we saw hitting record highs in 2022? And where does that leave the loonie?
Right. So I think, you know, the big story in currency markets globally here, at least since September, maybe early October, has been that decline in the dollar. You know, and this is sort of coming on the back of a change in the dollar's position in global markets. And so, you know, the Fed is now, you know, one of the less hawkish central banks globally. You know, you still have the European Central Bank, the Bank of England hiking. We have a fading in the energy shock. You know, prices have come down and we have, you know, a fading in the impact on the European economy. And we also have China reopening and lifting sort of global demand expectations. So all of that has contrived to kind of push down on the US dollar on a trade weighted basis. But the Canadian dollar has weakened, you know, in line with that. And I think, you know, the main reason here is that that markets are worried about what happens to consumption in the Canadian economy if we see housing continue to weaken. So, you know, if the housing market continues to fall and, you know, rate increases that happened last year continue to feed through into household spending patterns, that could impact the Canadian economy. That could push the Bank of Canada toward, you know, cutting more quickly than the Federal Reserve across the border.
You've mentioned some of the shocks, energy shocks, central banks and their policies, the war in Ukraine, all responsible for those currency fluctuations. In the past, you and I have spoken about how this is a fragile period in currency markets. Anything else on your radar that would be responsible for that?
Yeah, I think, you know, to some extent, those geopolitical shocks are sort of moving to the sidelines. But I guess how I would characterize 2023 is it's sort of the year of the whiplash. You know, we're going to see the lagging impacts of the policy response last year hitting most major economies. And so, you know, what we do expect is sort of non-linear trading mechanics, which sounds like a very, I guess, highfalutin way to say it. But, you know, we're looking at cases where currencies go in one direction and reverse and move in the opposite direction, sort of on a dime. And this is a huge contrast with where we were last year. Last year, you know, the US dollar was powering higher, and that was sort of like an unstoppable juggernaut that that everybody tried to get out of the way of. So this year, you know, we're expecting to see sort of bullwhip effects play out, you know, cases where we have sort of over-optimism, like maybe where we are today, you know, when everyone's sort of thinking about a soft landing and you know, the risk-sensitive currencies like the Canadian dollar are outperforming. But, you know, we could also see a moment somewhere in the middle of the year where we have sort of almost a Wile E. Coyote moment and everyone looks down and realizes, you know, maybe the underpinnings of this economy are not so solid and we should, you know, protect ourselves.
We have talked about that new relationship between oil and the dollar. Do you think this changed relationship is here to stay, or will it ever revert back to what it was before?
Right. I don't think we're ever going back to where we were. There was a point there where, you know, the petrol loonie was clearly the dynamic. If you talk to almost anyone in the world, especially in the currency markets, the assumption was that that the Canadian balance of trade and the Canadian economy were driven by crude exports. That has sort of fallen apart in recent years. Partly because the Canadian economy has shifted and you know, most of the economy is being driven by domestic consumption, but also partly by the fact that the U.S. has become quasi-energy independent. In other words, you know, the U.S. has been able to participate this year as oil prices have risen. The U.S. has actually seen an improvement in its terms of trade. So we're no longer in that sort of binary relationship where oil prices go up, Canadian dollar goes up. You know, at some point we're likely to see correlations improve from where they are, but it's not likely to become the major driver of the currency anytime soon.
The IMF recently upped its global growth forecast. What does that do to currencies around the world? And I guess specifically the US dollar.
Right. So, you know, I was kind of thinking about this yesterday. So the IMF in 2007 said, you know, that the global economy was going to essentially have clear sailing in 2008. And I think currency markets, traders, investors, you know, most market participants look at this with some skepticism, right? So they do assemble their opinions, you know, looking at the data that's coming in and not necessarily IMF forecasts. However, the IMF is clearly reflecting an improvement. You know, we are looking at global markets being driven by sort of a sense of cautious optimism here. We are looking at global markets that are more confident about what might happen later in the year. And this is largely a function of the fact that, you know, we have seen labor markets essentially not move. They're very, very strong across most developed economies. And, you know, the fact that inflation pressures are beginning to subside. So, you know, this idea of a soft landing has gained pretty significant exposure in recent weeks. And that is driving currencies sort of onward and upward here. This is really what is driving other currencies around the world up against the safe haven dollar.
Lastly, when you take a look at the trajectory of the US dollar and the loonie for 2023, where do you expect them to land?
Yeah, I think so. Initially, I think we're going to see a little bit of strength here. I do think that the Canadian dollar is likely oversold on the fundamentals. We may have, you know, a boost of optimism coming down the pipe in the next couple of weeks and even the next couple of months. But beyond that, we do expect those sort of domestic vulnerabilities to take over again. You know, the fact that the Canadian households are going to change spending patterns, that we are likely to see that sort of ripple out into the rest of the economy. I think that that is going to drag the Canadian dollar down maybe another 3 or 4 cents from where we are today by the end of the year. So, you know, we're looking at, again, sort of a non-linear environment here in which we don't see a clear trend emerging through the year. It could get very, very bumpy.